Simon & Schuster Audio presents Winning the Green New Deal, Why We Must, How We Can. Edited by Varshini Prakash and Guido Girgenti of the Sunrise Movement. Read by Joniece Abbott-Pratt, Priya Ayyar, Inés del Castillo, Samantha Desz, Timothy Andrés Pabon, Jonathan Todd Ross, David Sadzin, and Shaun Taylor-Corbett.
Introduction. The Adults in the Room. Varshini Prakash. I don't know how to say this, except to just say it. Young people have got to rise up. That's it. That's the message. If you take one thing away from this book, let it be the courage to rise up alongside your friends and classmates and neighbors to demand a safe future for all of us. And the certainty that if we rise together, we will win. I had that rise-up feeling when I awoke early on September 20th, 2019. While I'd been asleep in the U.S., millions of young people around the world had been pouring out onto the streets of cities and towns, small and large, in unprecedented numbers. I scrolled through Twitter from my bed, awestruck at images of schoolchildren in Delhi chanting in unison, thousands in Japan, hundreds of thousands pouring out across Australia. Over 1.4 million people were already striking in Germany. In every country, thousands of youths gathered with homemade signs, images of the earth, and words scrawled onto pieces of paper. My personal favorite: if you won't be the adults, then we will. I swung out of bed, ready to join tens of thousands more in New York City, where leaders like the indomitable 16-year-old Greta Thunberg would be rallying. I made my way to Foley Square, the sidewalk streaming with teenagers hours before the march was set to begin. Groups of schoolchildren covered the green, some who couldn't have been older than 5 or 6, standing alongside teachers and parents holding banners. Thousands of teenagers were excused from class by New York City's Department of Education so they could strike. I caught up with activists like 14-year-old Alexandria Villasenor and 16-year-old Jamie Margolin. The average age of the protesters was a full 3 decades lower than at any other mass demonstration I'd attended. The energy was palpable, buoyant, and fierce, heightened by the rising heat of the day. I made my way to the stage, pushing through throngs of young people of all races, from every borough in the city, arriving backstage just as the first speakers bellowed into the microphone. I looked out at the vast numbers reaching as far back as the eye could see. I'll tell you, there is nothing more beautiful than thousands of people standing as one, in active hope for a better future. And yet, as I peered out, tears began flooding down my face, and I felt a tightness in my stomach. These were children. And they were compelled, instead of playing with their peers, or studying, or hanging out on a Friday afternoon and enjoying the last few moments of summer, to march, to fight, to demand, to plead for their futures. They knew irrevocable damage may be done long before they reach voting age or can run for office. They would be left in stewardship of a treacherous world, while older generations, dead and gone, would never face the consequences of their ruinous actions. We are defined not by the conditions in which we find ourselves, but in how we choose to respond. In this moment, it was apparent that against all odds, young people were choosing to fight back. Young people were choosing hope. Young people were choosing life. We are not the first generation to witness environmental disaster, but we are the last with the power to stop its cataclysmic force. We haven't caused this problem, nor do we know how our future will unfold, and yet we are choosing responsibility and action, choosing each other over isolation, fear, and retreat. It's a scary thing, but it's all the more possible when we do it together. All this rushed through my head when suddenly my name was called. I stepped up, the sun beating down, to a cheering crowd of 250,000 people. My strength came back, soaring into my lungs, and I jumped up onto the stage. When I first learned about the climate crisis as a kid, I would lie awake late into the night, heart pounding, imagining what it would mean for me and people who looked like me around the world. I couldn't get the images out of my head of what people would do to each other when they were faced with no food or water, with cages and guns, when they sought sanctuary in other countries. I felt alone, small, powerless. Today, this generation is taking over. Our days of waiting for justice, our days of waiting for action, our days of waiting to be heard are over. We'll put our feet to the streets until we get it done. Today, kids don't have to feel small and alone and powerless. They can know they are part of the most important movement that's shaking our world from its roots. That day, 7 million people went on strike. This is the movement that is going to win a Green New Deal. What is your plan? That rise up feeling comes in many different flavors. In September 2019, I was ready to rise from a place of joy and optimism. But less than a year prior, I was enraged. On November 7, 2018, the morning after Election Day, I woke to the news that Nancy Pelosi, fresh off her victory in the midterms, would be using her new powers as Speaker of the House to create a committee to educate the public about the impact of more frequent extreme weather events. This was personal for me. Sunrise Movement, the youth movement of which I am a co-founder and the executive director, had been building toward this election since our foundation in mid-2017. We set out on a mission to make climate change matter in the midterms. As a key step toward our eventual goal of winning comprehensive policies to stop climate change while creating millions of good jobs. Our election strategy focused on exposing both Democrats and Republicans for their financial ties to the fossil fuel executives profiting from climate change, while supporting those Democrats who would swear off fossil fuel money and back ambitious climate policy. Unlike some other climate groups, we wouldn't focus any energy on educating or persuading GOP candidates. The few climate-conscious GOP politicians had long since been expelled from office by the party's billionaire fossil fuel financiers, while the party as a whole displayed increasingly open contempt for people of color, democracy, and the bipartisanship that prior generations held dear. The GOP was simply too far gone. That's why sunrisers around the country had been busting our butts from June through November to register voters and promote candidates, all of them Democrats. 4 million more young people turned out to vote than in the last midterm election, helping Democrats reclaim the House of Representatives. Our generation backed the Dems without hesitation because of the obvious need to put a check on Donald Trump, but also without enthusiasm, because it was equally obvious that the Democrats still had no plan to actually solve the massive problems casting a shadow over our future. Sunrise's efforts had raised the profile of climate change in some races, but it was evident we still weren't where we needed to be. And now, Pelosi had confirmed that her climate strategy extended no further than educate the public through a series of stuffy congressional hearings that nobody would hear about. Personally, I thought the wildfires raging across California and blanketing the news were education enough. I was scared, angry, and ready to rise up. 6 days later, I walked with 200 others into a Washington, D.C. office building to visit Pelosi in person. We flooded the halls with yellow and black signs, repeating a desperate message. We have 12 years. What is your plan? We already knew the answer, of course, but I'll come back to that later. I'd been to events like this before. I'd marched against the Keystone XL pipeline. I'd sat in the offices of my college administrators until they divested the school's endowments from fossil fuels. I'd been arrested working to shut down a polluting coal plant in southern Massachusetts. I'd learned the hard way that victory usually doesn't come the same day that we sit in at a congressional office. Organizing to stop the climate crisis and secure jobs and justice for all Americans is daunting, in part because we are already starting so far behind from where we need to be, and we never win everything we need at once. We watch our homes and our neighbors perish in the California wildfires. We get a call from our relatives across the world telling us of the floods they hope to escape. We ask ourselves why these fires and floods keep getting worse. And our questions.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.